Okay, so Sean presented a very important picture for us is in terms of number of people who learn the new skills and the way they participate in neighborhoods, how long they participate in neighborhoods, make a difference in, you know, in their life. So what I'm trying to do now is I want to show you some of the findings we have in two things. One is, what are they, you know, after they participate in neighborhoods, okay, what really make difference in their life, okay? How are they going to be, you know, become from a surface user and become now a leader in neighborhoods? So this is what I want to show you. So we look at how many board member, we did a, we call Keering House Survey to all the neighborhoods. This is what we find. Among all the board members, there are all together 24 different languages, you know, being spoken by different, you know, board members among all the neighborhoods. And in 15 houses, English is the dominant one, and then French, and then Spanish, Chinese, and Hindi. So you can imagine, in many neighborhoods, the board member, you know, they themselves are immigrants, right, with a second language coming to Canada. And if we look at, you know, how many of those board members sitting at the governance board or the, we call community board of all the neighborhoods, we can see a few of them are surface user or have been surface user of these labor houses. So someone who already have the knowledge of labor houses, they join the board, okay? So that the board, you know, which is the highest level governance body, okay, will know, okay, what people in the community and what the people who come to the labor houses will need. And if we also look at the immigrant status of all the board member. So you can tell, 73% of the board members are local born, okay, they're born in Canada, but we still have 27% of the board members who are immigrants themselves. So here, basically, you can tell some of the surface user, particularly immigrants, throughout the, you know, the, we call the pathway in labor houses, they have become from surface user and, you know, and become the leader of the labor house. So if we look at the board member as immigrants compared to the populations of the labor houses, they, you know, the areas they serve, the red line, the red bar indicates, you know, people, the, you know, immigrants in the local areas that each labor house serve. And the blue bar indicates how many immigrants on the board of, you know, this particular labor house. So from that you can tell most of the labor houses have some members, some board members who are immigrants. But compared to the population, probably they have to do something more to, you know, to recruit more immigrants into the board, you know, to their board, okay, in order to meet the, you know, to meet the representativeness of the populations in the area they serve. But if we look at the staff, this is a very different picture. So altogether, according to what we gather, among all the staff working in the, all the 15 neighborhoods back then, we have 25 different ethnicities, 25 different ethnicities. And Canadian and Chinese are the top ethnic groups working in the labor house. Well, I would say Canadian may not be an ethnic group, but I'm just using, you know, a simple way to talk about that. And then we also have, you know, South Asian and other. But the second one is, if you look at, you know, whether this staff have been a surface user of labor house, you find it very interesting. Only 37.2% of the staff working in labor houses who have never used the services at labor house. So in other words, almost 60% of the staff themselves have been a surface user of labor house. So this is important. As you can imagine, someone who have used the service or who have been using the service, they will know better what people really need, right? So, and also they can really, you know, build a good relations with the service user because they themselves is either a service user now or have been a service user. And if you look at the immigrant status, okay, this is even more interesting. Half of the, you know, staff working in labor house born in Canada, and half of them are immigrants themselves. So in other words, you know, according to what, you know, Sean just reported, many of them have learned, you know, as surface user to labor house, they have learned good skills. And then they can turn these skills into a job skills, and also to stay in labor house to serve, you know, other people. So this is a very important, you know, pathway, you know, from what we gather. Means people not just, you know, as a service user. Immigrants is not just service user to labor house. They can be a leader of labor house in different capacity. So if, again, this is a, you know, a bar chart that we are trying to show you. If you look at this bar chart, again, the blue one is about the staff information we collect. And the red one is about the census data we have in terms of percentage. Half of the labor houses have their staff, percentage of staff as immigrants higher than the percentage of immigrants living in the area that they serve. Okay, and half is slightly lower. So in other words, you know, at least half of the labor houses have, you know, really, really trying to reflect the population they serve, you know, among their staff. So in order to understand better how this pathway, you know, work, we conduct an oral history. So we did in-depth interview with 45 people. 9 of them are board member when we were interviewing them, and 28 were staff, and 6 were volunteer leaders, and 2 local leaders. So 25 of the people we interviewed were first generation immigrants, means they were not born in Canada. And over 5 of them are, you know, second generation, means they came from, you know, immigrants' family. They born in Canada, but they came from the immigrants' family. So this is the, you know, a conceptual map, you know, we're trying to put together. So when people, when, you know, many immigrants, when they start going to labor house, they may be a service user as a beginning. Some of them start right away as volunteer, and some, you know, may even, you know, became a part-time staff. So they, you know, in this circle for a while, once they, you know, accumulate enough experience and skills, and they were promoted into this, you know, circle. This is the leadership circle. So in the leadership circle, some of them, most of them are at the staff level, means they become, you know, not part-time staff now, they become full-time staff, permanent staff of labor houses. And some, you know, may stay as a senior volunteer, okay? Means, you know, they lead other groups, you know, they provide leadership to other volunteers. And some will, you know, a small group of immigrants will move on to become a member of the board. So the reason why I try to use this kind of image, because I want to show you this is not a linear process. In other words, okay, at one point, the staff may leave, but they will still come, you know, they will come back as a service user. So these two, you know, wheels, you know, bigger wheels, they basically one with each other. So in other words, you know, throughout the whole trajectories, okay, people can, you know, move from the user, the passive user, you know, circle to a more active leadership circle, and sometimes they may go back, and sometimes they may go back again. So this is how we find out, you know, people's moving around in neighborhood houses, you know, particularly among immigrants. So we also asked them, okay, so what, how labor houses help them to build their capacity? I think, you know, Sean already, you know, show you what kind of capacity they have learned or gained from labor house. So when we asked them in the interview, many of them told us, okay, labor house, first of all, first and foremost, the most important thing is meet the needs as a newcomers of them, okay? When they come to Canada, they're new, they don't know anything. So labor house, you know, basically satisfy many of their needs, such as, you know, they provide programs for their children. Actually, you know, interestingly is children is the key connection between immigrants and labor house. Because most of the time, because of children going to labor house for daycare program, for after school program, they draw the parents to the labor house. And then the parents become active member of the labor house. And also there are lots of intergeneration programs provided in labor house, and that also facilitate the newcomers, you know, to joining the labor houses. Second thing people told us is labor house is a place of connections and support. It's a place for them to break the isolation. As you can imagine, you move to a new country, a new community, you know nobody there. Labor house provide the opportunity for you to start knowing people. Again, you know, statistically we have proven labor house is very important, you know, as a connection site. And they also mentioned that labor house is not just a hub for them to connect with people. Labor house is a safe place. One of the participants, she grew up in labor house when she was very young. Okay, she said, my mom feels very comfortable for us to go to labor house alone because they know what it is about. They know everybody, you know, all the workers there. They know all the volunteers there. Okay, so when they need a kid going to labor house, okay, they just feel they're going from, you know, their own home, the first home, to a second home. So parents feel safe, and that's how, you know, the space, not just for parents, okay, it's also for other people, you know, not just for children. It's also a safe base for many newcomers to explore this new country. Actually, I have a picture I didn't show here. A few years ago when I went to China to present, to introduce labor house to them, I went to one of the labor house, I took a picture at the lobby, and someone was sleeping in the lobby. So I showed it to my colleagues in China, and they were so surprised. How come somebody was sleeping there, nobody go and, you know, wake this guy up and ask him to go somewhere? And I said, this is exactly what labor house built, you know, it's beauty of labor house. As long as you don't disturb people, you're free to sleep there. So it's safe place. And also it's a place, you know, for people to develop and, you know, a sense of belonging to, you know, not only to other people, but to the community. So very often to many newcomers, immigrants, okay, labor house represent the community. So when we always say, okay, people have to build a sense of belonging, what are we going to, you know, belong to, right? So labor house is a proxy of the community and also a proxy of the country. And the first thing they also mentioned is, you know, after, you know, when they're going through the pathway at labor house also provide them a aspirations, okay, something they can look up to, something they can, you know, imagine they can do in Canada. So it's a, you know, it contributes to the discovery of their own education and also their own career goal. As you may know, many immigrants after they move to Canada or to many new countries, they have to start a new career again. So many of them have to really rethink, okay, what they can do or what they can do good. And labor house provides this opportunity for them to think about, okay, their future career in a new country. And also like their interests and passions of working with people. So there are lots of people, they used to work in different kind of jobs in labor, you know, in their home country. But coming to labor house, they see the other side of the world, right? So they pick up another types of jobs, particularly jobs that can help people, jobs that can really change the community. And also is, you know, to many of our participants, they also told us that going to labor house, okay, also contribute to their self-development. It fosters their self-growing and also their self-discovery. So many people may not have the time, may not have the opportunity to really reflect on their life. And going to labor house, you know, they see different people, they see different opportunity. So they also, you know, reflect on themselves. And it improved their self-confidence and social skills. I think, you know, Sean's presentation is a good indicator. Enhance the empathy and non-judgmental, the non-judgment. As you can imagine, Canada is a very free country, okay? We are one of the countries, you know, one of the, you know, the first group of countries who recognize same-sex marriage. But to many immigrants coming to these countries, coming from those cultures, they don't, you know, see homosexuality as something they will accept. Sometimes it's difficult for them to really understand, okay, what's going on in this country. So labor house, you know, helping them to understand, you know, the diversity, the cultural values of this country, and also helping them to learn, okay, not to judge people, okay, try to, you know, really learn how to accept people. And nurturing the values of community participation, right? So now they are part of the community. What does it mean, you know, have to, you know, participation is, okay? How does individual of them, okay, can contribute to the community, not just as someone living there, but as someone who can really make a difference in the community. And also bring new meanings to their life. I think this is very important to many newcomers, okay, particularly when they are a little bit disenfranchised, you know, by the reality they have to face in, you know, in the job market, in other areas. Labor houses give them a very welcoming, very safe area to find a new meaning of life in a new country. And the fifth one is provide career and leadership opportunity. Definitely, as I've shown you already, you can tell, you know, half of the staff were, you know, immigrants themselves. So it's a way for them to really get into the labor market and move up the job, you know, the labor market ladders. So create job opportunity for volunteering. I call this, you know, In Canada, I use the term volunteering syndrome. It's a syndrome in a way that, you know, as newcomers to this country, everybody get an advice from somewhere else. You have to, you know, do volunteer work before you can get a real work. Because, you know, when you're going to apply for a job in Canada, the first thing they ask you is, do you have Canadian experience? Even though that means basically nothing, okay, because nobody exactly know what Canadian experience is. But this is the cliche, okay, everybody will ask, okay, do you have Canadian experience? So in order to gain Canadian experience, people will advise, go and, you know, go and do some volunteer work and then you can put on your resume, okay, that is kind of Canadian experience. So to a certain extent, labor houses, you know, serve this purpose, okay, they provide opportunity for people to volunteer. But of course, volunteering have multiple meanings to many people, right? Gaining Canadian experience is one, but return, you know, payback to the community is another one. So in the beginning, some of them may just want to get the Canadian experience, but slowly, slowly they see the, you know, the importance of, you know, give and take. So it also changed the meaning of volunteering, you know, to many newcomers. And many of them get a first job, believe it or not, okay, in neighborhood house, after they volunteer for a while and, you know, they demonstrate their ability. And some, you know, some neighborhood house just offer them job. One example I get is, you know, one woman came from Middle East, and she basically never worked, or even in her home country. But she's a very good chef. So when she went to this labor house, you know, the staff asked her, okay, what do you really want to do? Oh, I like cooking, okay. If I can cook, I will be, you know, I can contribute. So then they invite this woman to start, you know, making some of her homemade food in some of the events. And people loved those food. So then the labor house decided to hire her as a part-time chef. So she got the first job ever in her life as a chef. And now I think, you know, she's still working in the labor house as a full-time chef for all the programs they have. So then you can imagine, you know, this is a pace for them to find themselves and also get them the first job. And which, you know, recognize their skills, you know, skills they learn and also their strength. And by getting a job also enrich their experience and skills through different programs. So some people, before they move up to a senior level in the organizations, have, you know, tried different programs. So each program they try to run or facilitate, they learn some skills. And also offer them a leadership programs and mentorship. So many labor houses, you know, provide leadership program and mentorship to newcomers. And that are, you know, some ways to improve and also to enrich their skills. So this is what we find so far, okay, among all the participants in the interview. It's not just going to labor house for service for most of the immigrants. By getting the service, they also enhance their own skills and experience. And labor house provide them, you know, the opportunity and also the context for them to, number one, you know, to get some, you know, so-called Canadian experience. Number two, getting some, you know, real skills, new skills. And then number three is recognizing their skills and offering them job. So the next presentation will be, you know, we will focus more on the senior, and our colleagues from South Vancouver Labor House will talk about how they engage senior immigrants in their work.